take that back. There were two. It was Adam before he sinned. He was holy. He was without sin before he transgressed, before he ate of the forbidden fruit. And there was Jesus Christ. Those are the only two who were ever without sin. Okay. And there was only one God-man, that's Christ. Now, Adam was without sin, but he was not divine. He was not the God-man. He was the created man. Jesus Christ is not created. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit in the womb of Mary, but he's always existed. He said, before Abraham was, I am. He became a man, but he wasn't. He was never created. He's always existed. So, you have to realize that if anybody says they have not sinned, then you better run. Some of the cults that say that, sin is not real. We don't even sin. That's a lie. If anybody these preachers on television, such as Joel Osteen and Jakes and all those millionaire preachers, you notice they don't ever talk about sin. Because people don't want to hear about that. People want to hear about how to get rich, how to advance in this world, how do I get the things I want, live a comfortable life. It ain't about that. It's not comfortable handing out gospel tracts and, living for the Lord. It's not comfortable. Nobody. It's not enjoyable. But it's something we have to do because we've been commanded to make disciples, share the gospel. Not comfortable living a holy life. It's something we have to do if we want to have fellowship with God. Verse 9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now notice, it doesn't say anything in the Bible about confessing your sin to a priest, as the Roman Catholics do. That's not scriptural. It says if we confess our sins to God. Now, if you sin against somebody, then you should confess your fault to them and to God. Because ultimately, anytime you sin, you're offending God. You're transgressing His word. But there are times when you sin against your neighbor, you need to confess. So we confess our sin. He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin. And that's the greatest promise in the Word of God. Knowing that God is faithful, He will forgive you. He will forgive me. He's promised. It's written right there. He's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all iniquity. That's the blessed promise of God, the most. All we have to do is confess it to God. And of course, repent of it too. But confession comes first. Admitting the fact you've done wrong. And then asking God for strength not to do it again. Wisdom. Solomon, he had the wisdom of this world, but he wasn't very wise in the things of God. Anybody who has 700 wives and 300 concubines, my biblical understanding is not walking in obedience to the Word of God. You're only supposed to have one wife, not 1,000. He was obviously not born again. He believed in God. But his sinful nature obviously was controlling him. actually in that realm of women. You can't be born again and have 1,000 wives. That's not biblical. David too. The people of the Old Testament were not born again. People of the Old Testament, they had the promises of God. They had faith in God. They were saved by their faith, but they were not regenerate. They couldn't live that Christian life. But the Holy Spirit, by the way, wasn't giving up. Christ hadn't come yet. They were not new creations. Because you can't be a new creation unless the Holy Spirit makes you alive. So they were constantly, you know, throughout the Old Testament, they were constantly disobeying God. Children of Israel. Constantly. Always going astray. Going after other gods. Committing adultery. Fornication. Constantly. Repeatedly throughout the Old Testament. Why? Because they didn't have the Holy Spirit. That's why. They were waiting for the fulfillment of Christ. So that one day the Holy Spirit could come and dwell permanently in our temples. Give us that new nature, that Christ nature. And we can do those things for pleasing God. Amen. And finally, verse 10 says, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. So that's basically a repetition of verse 8. We say we have not sinned and make no lie. You have to realize you're a sinner. If you want to be saved, you can't be saved if you don't admit the fact that you're a sinner. Admitting the fact you're a sinner is paramount. It's fundamental. If you don't admit that fact, you can't be saved. Jesus said, I didn't come to save the righteous, I came to save sinners. Admitting, knowing the fact you're a sinner, confessing your sinful nature, you need to be saved, confessing your sin daily, hourly, minutely, we talked about the sense. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. So people don't want to admit they're sinners, but you were born a sinner, we all were. And the only one who's without sin, that's God. Only one. He's commanded us to live holy lives, God-fearing lives. He knows we're not perfect, but he expects us to confess our sin to him and to repent of it with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. And we only offer partial obedience. That doesn't cut it with God. He wants all of our heart. He wants complete obedience, complete yielding. Okay, why? He's not trying to keep something good from us. He's trying to give something good to us. Namely, fellowship with himself. The blessed life. Life of obedience is the blessed life. It's the life of fellowship with God. You live in disobedience, you don't have no fellowship with God. You're just walking in the dark. You know when you walk in the dark, you're going to bang your head into stuff. You're going to hurt yourself. Bang your shin, your foot, your head. You're going to be able to see what you're doing. You know direction. But if you walk in the light as he is light, he'll give you direction. He'll give you purpose, meaning, fulfillment, wisdom. I'll close the word of prayer when we finish. Heavenly Father, we just thank you and praise the promises of your word for the forgiveness of our sins. We thank you, O God. We pray you will grant us the grace to live those godly-fearing, upright lives, so pleasing your sight. We give you the glory, honor, and praise in Christ's name.